here representing the Department of Southeast Asian Studies and also the Centre for the Study of Southeast Asia at SOAS. And we are primarily, I am here to welcome you. This event is to celebrate part of the celebrations of Singapore's 50th birthday. And this year at SOAS, we're also celebrating SOAS's 100th birthday. So lots of reasons to be excited about Singapore and the study of Southeast Asia. So very briefly, before the film starts, I'd just like to thank the Singapore High Commission, represented today by Cheryl Toh, who I think is here, there she is, and the Singapore International Foundation, who funded the project that you're about to see, which is itself the Singaporean film community's response to the celebration of Singapore's 50th birthday. One of the directors of the seven short films that you're about to see, Royston Tang, is here in the audience. And next to him is Chris Berry from King's College down the road. And the two of them will be in conversation afterwards. There'll be a Q&A after that once the film has been shown. So obviously if you need to leave, you're allowed to leave. But if you'd like to stay and listen to Royston talking to Chris about the film and the project in general, then you're very welcome. Royston's also told me that different directors of this collection of short films have been dispatched around the globe to where screenings have been taking place. He was in Mexico very recently and is now here via Singapore. And I think he's rather jet-lagged, so please be kind when you put your questions. But we're very delighted that you're here to represent the project. And I think I'm probably supposed to say that the fire exits are over there and here. And this is that hosting fence here. And if the fire alarm goes off, we're not going to start the drill. So do make your way outside. So without further ado, we look forward to this evening's screening of Seven Letters, and I hope you enjoy it very much. Thank you.
And there's write a very personal letter to Singapore on the 50th birthday, and you know, all of them, even we have a central theme, which is home, and what is your definition of home, and the era that you're most familiar with. So you have filmmakers who are very, very young, and you have filmmakers who are very, very old, and filmmakers who are very old and very young. So you know, and very easily, we, you know, the era has been established very quickly. Yeah.
And in terms of so what is the kind of the logic of starting with the Eric Kutz film and going through with the last film? I mean, I just wondered how, what is the point of reverse? I wonder why choosing to put them in that order?
It's purely based on the era.
Purely on that?
Yeah, like Eric wanted to do the 50s and Jack is familiar with the 60s to the 70s. And so it falls into a very organic way. And also because we wanted to give a surprise to the seven directors, because they didn't know what each other were doing.
Uh-huh.
Yeah. So they only know that by definition of which era they're doing. So when the whole film came out, it was also the first time they watch it, and there are similar themes, similar thread of subjects that's exploring.
Right, that's what I noticed. I mean, it's a celebration of 50 years of Singapore, but the films are very poignant, actually. I mean, they're very often about parting, about missing people, and also it's very often about the connection to Malaysia, right?
Mm.
So I wondered how people responded when you showed the film in Singapore, and how they felt about that, because, as I say, it's not some sort of rah-rah nationalistic celebration film at all. It's much more complex than that.
I think maybe I should talk about when this film premiered in Malaysia. The reaction was very, very strong. They felt that they had never left us. We are just separated by one river.
Mm.
And I think this film is also a reflection of what we have achieved and what we have lost.
Yeah, I felt that very strongly. How about the government, since they funded it? Are they happy with it?
They were very happy. I think this project is groundbreaking, because this is the one and only project that has no interference from the government at all. It's purely based on the word trust. That's what I told them. SG50 should also be based on trust. So the whole entire project was only presented with two pieces of paper. Then what we're gonna do roughly, and I said no script were given, and when we finished the final product, and when they saw it, they loved it.
That's very interesting, because when I deal with government people, they're not usually that sophisticated about these kinds of things. And for birthday celebration stuff, national celebrations, they usually want something much more, as I say, celebratory, upbeat, looking to the future. So it's interesting to hear that they responded so positively.
Yes.
Do you think there have been big change? Because the people in the Singapore film industry have had in the past, including yourself, I think, sometimes not such easy relations. So do you think there's been some changes? And things that it seems very different.
The environment has definitely opened up. Maybe also because I'm a little bit more upbeat, right? So the way I speak to them is a little bit rude. I think that, okay, if somebody comes to your birthday celebration, then would you want to check their receipt for the present that they're going to give you? So the relationship between the artist as well as the person that we are going to celebrate for. So take this SG50 celebration as a test of trust between the artist and the government. And we are artists are not out there to destroy people.
I'm wondering if at this point maybe I can open things up. Do you have any questions or any comments? I think we've got some people with microphones, so if you'd like to put your hand up, and we'd be happy to hear your reflections. Let us know what you thought about spells. Down here.
Hello, hi, my name is Janice. I'm Singaporean, I've been working here for a year and a half, and this is my Malaysian friend, May. She's
been working here for
13 years. So I came to London a year and a half ago, and because I wanted to reinvent myself, and after I watched this, especially the last one, I feel like I want to go home. It stirred something in me. And my question to Royston is, what's the inspiration behind your film, your part of the film?
My film talks about Bunga's, it's Bunga Saya, and I was very inspired by the Lee song. I'm always wondering about back in my segment is in the 80s, and there was a lot of like Speak Good English campaign, Speak Mandarin campaign, and all this campaign. But I do feel like back then in the company, when it was life was simpler, you don't need to use all this campaign to communicate. It, you know, sometimes just the very basic body language is enough. I'm also very fascinated by our HDB culture, like you know, how neighbor communicate sometimes through the window, and it's like when it's raining, then you know, look out and shout to the neighbor to bring their clothes and all this. But this is also from some of my personal experience. Also,
I was wondering if it was a little biographical.
Yes, there was a period of time where there's no water in my house. Mine was a little bit more sensational. I just read in Nikkei.
So, what's the idea behind this one quite corny part, right, where you have the rainbow and...
Yeah.
What was the idea behind the juxtaposition of that?
It was just myself in the audience. I always make musical film. I just have to have one musical film. So that's my... Yeah.
That's all. Thank you.
Reflections, and I understand because things are changing so rapidly, it's quite frightening. Even things that I have now become used to and really fall in love with, like World Trunk, is going down. The HDBs there, which I think are absolutely poetic. And these all bring them into context. It's really quite lovely. But I was thinking something you said about the government with the trust. There is something that you did. You add, each one of you adds a moralistic kind of tag line at the end, which I'm sure the government loves. So, I think, you know, because living there now, I realize this kind of morality that's fed into your everydayism, of why you do things, of how you do things, of what you should be doing, et cetera, et cetera. So, yeah, I see that kind of, you know, we're doing this, but they're beautiful films. They're absolutely poetic and so touching, and really hitting on different strands of the life. Yeah, thank you.
director, I'm not wrong. I must congratulate you because you have such some of the universal themes. For example, like love, like the problems of old age, like adoption of children, like the new landscape of economics and environment, and also the in a beautiful, vivid way, you have spoken of love and humanity. The message is very subtle, but to me, these seven movies, they were seven wonders of your artistic creation. I congratulate you.
Firstly, this film, we didn't have a particular audience because it's not meant for to be a commercial film. It was really meant to be just a 3 days screen. The reaction was very, very huge. After 3 days of the screening, and people write into the papers, and there was an extension of six more screenings with the National Museum. And after that, people queued for 3 hours to watch the film. It's something that we didn't expect at all. And then after that, they brought me to the cinema chain, you know, to block a film in maybe 1 year in advance. But there was no spot for us, so it was a petition. And this other school, the cinema district. And we had a three weeks run. And we don't have an audience in mind. I guess it's just purely our point. And the stories that really matters to us, that we want to document. Maybe 10 years from now, when you look back, when somebody passed away in your family, at the team meeting, you can relate to that.
Dying to know how the filmmaker persuaded Juliette Binoche on the bridge next to Boat Quay. The circumstances around that would be fascinating. Lovely film, by the way.
So what happened was Juliette Binoche was she's a very good friend with Eric Rood, and she just happened to be at the Singapore International Film Festival, and she wanted to visit Eric. Sound design for this,
up as a young child. Just like to say that I found a lot of the films very touching. Some of the earlier ones really reminded me of even some of the stories that my mother used to tell me when I was younger from her childhood. My question to you actually is, out of like the films apart from your own, out of the films there, which one's your favourite and why?
which is my favourite?
Yeah.
Okay, I think my favourite has to be the end credit, which is the longest end credit ever, because really when I felt very moved when I saw the end credits, because you see, in fact, all the filmmakers, when you approach them to when they agree to do this project, they were all making their own feature film. They put all their projects aside to finish this. And like, the film industry in Singapore is like a little seven, it's like mafia gangs, you know. This group don't mix with this group, that group doesn't mix. But for one, in this film, everybody appeared together. And that was something very magical for me. I think it brings everybody together.
Very interesting aspect of the film, of course, is, you know, with particularly about the film industry in Singapore, with Eric Koo's film at the beginning, you know, he talks about this being a legacy that has continued, right? I forgot the exact sentence, but he, you know, talks about it as being a legacy. But actually, as we know, you know, there was this gap where there was no feature film in Singapore, because once Singapore and Malaysia were separate, market that the films were being made from in late 40s and 50s was not there for Singapore anymore. And it's only recently that the Singapore film industry has come back. Mm-hmm. And I wonder if you've got any comments on why you think, not just why you think it's come back, but why it's been able to sustain itself. Because it's just, you know, it's grown and grown, and that's been really a remarkable story of where in the rest of the world we're seeing national cinemas more and more disappearing or knocked down by, you know, the Hollywood behemoths and so on. But somehow Singapore film industry has come back from making no feature films to a fairly steady annual output. I wonder what your reflections are on that.
I think there are two very important factors. Firstly, is the Singapore International Film Festival. It has opened up a lot of windows for local filmmakers to interact with foreign filmmakers and local audience to watch a more diverse kind of films. And also with the new grants coming from MDA, which is the Singapore Media Authority of Singapore, many grants have been given to first-time, second-time director, and even established filmmakers also. And also we have the co-production treaty with different countries, especially with Malaysia. So right now we have co-production. There's a lot of collaboration with Malaysia that's happening. So these are the two main factors. It's always my personal wish that because Singapore we are progressing very, very fast. I sometimes wish that we would just slow down a little bit for the older generation or even for people who are unable to catch up. Yeah. So this is something that I always try to do.
Hi, thank you. I really enjoyed the films, they were really great. I just have a couple of short questions. My first question is that in the film there are the use of a lot of dialects, and you know, I'm just wondering whether that is a conscious decision by the directors. Obviously some of the stories call for that when they're talking about the 70s and, you know, the early lives, etc. and all that. But given the government campaigns to speak Mandarin and to get rid of the dialects in the 1980s and 1990s. Do you think this is a kind of a tacit acknowledgement by the government that dialects are actually a very vital part of the culture, and for a culture to survive, it really has to also survive? So that's my first question. And my sort of second question is that, do you think that has an impact on encouraging the younger generations now to actually go back to speaking a lot more dialect? Because I know that there's a whole generation in between and they were wiped out. And you know, a lot of them actually may still understand some dialects because it's still spoken among the older generations, but they can't speak the dialects anymore.
Since all the directors are from so many different eras and do the self-reflection thing in our individual way. And if you would ask me what are the things that I want to capture today, I think it would be food. Like, a lot of things today, because it's changing. The taste of food is of chicken rice and
to present a token of appreciation to Mr. Royston Tan. And we're going to conduct this story. Inside we have Yakun Kaya and Yakun Kobi. Professor Jeffrey Watkins. Just by the way, thank you very much.